So yeah, my name's Tom, and I'm normally part of the Doctor Who podcast, but today at Hoover's, it's my considerable pleasure to welcome to the stage and honour Miss Deborah Watling.
Sort of something else. She was a Victorian Miss, but I didn't want her to be a wimp. So I tried to play a bit tomboyish, you know, because the worst thing you can play with bunny things.
Okay, so say your cast, and then you get to meet Fraser Myers and the great Patrick Troughton.
Yes.
What were your first impressions of Patrick Troughton and Fraser Myers?
Dear Pat, what can you say about Patrick Troughton? My first impression was that he was a very, very kind, friendly man, with a lovely sense of humour. And of course, we became very close, actually. He became like a second father to me. And over the year, we came closer and closer. Then I left, of course. It was my decision to be with the man after a year. I still saw him, but then he died, of course, many years ago. I think he's 23 years now. And I still miss him. I was very privileged to work with this wonderful man. And he was such a large part of my life. I actually have a photo of him in my kitchen dining room, next to my dad's photo, which is rather nice. Probably very sentimental, but I don't care. I'll never forget him. And I miss him to this day.
It does look like he was a very huge influence on you.
He was. Massive.
There's a couple of things I want to ask you about working with Patrick Troughton and Fraser Myers as well, I think. One of the things that's clear to me is that you were working on television at a time when it was very much televised theatre. So everything was very staged and the cameras were quite fixed. What I wonder is, do we have to learn a different set of skills? How did Patrick help you with that? Were you really well versed in that sort of thing?
I was actually quite well versed in that sort of thing by then, actually. I got quite a bit. Yes, but Pat and I and Fraser always used to help each other. We were like a family, like a team. And when we went home for weekends, etc., we couldn't wait to get back on Monday to be together again.
Was it quite a heavy schedule to be working as
well? It was. Sometimes it was 7 days a week if we were filming. Of course, Pat is a star. He had so many scenes and so many lines, and that's what made him rather ill. And he came up to me one day and said, I'm very worried, I've got palpitations. And I went, you've got to see the doctor now. Which he did, and they put him on pills. Goodness knows what. He survived quite some time.
See, this is the thing. What I noticed, again, from reading the book, is that when you know a text, you can form a relationship with it over a period of years. But when you work on Doctor Who, the scripts are changing every week.
Yes, that's great. You don't get bored. It's wonderful. You know, and then what are we going to go up to this week? Which monster's going to drag me away? Like, oh, it's brilliant. We'll give you that any time.
That sounds like quite good fun, actually. Do you have any favourite memories of your initial few weeks when you were finding your feet?
Not particularly. I mean, I was very shy when I first went into the nursing home. And at lunchtime, Pat and Fraser always used to go to the BBC club for lunch and a few of those. And I used to bring my little picnic box, and I wouldn't go to the BBC club. I had my glass of tea, my cat sandwiches, like I did at school. Then they actually encouraged me, said, oh, come on, Ted, come and join us. I said, I don't want to. I'm not going to. They said, no, come on. So eventually they persuaded me to join them. I've never looked back since.
Was it? Well, they were involved in Fraser and Rachel, which for most of the cameras basically didn't know. What do you think, is there anything specific that you think you learned from working with Patrick and Fraser that you haven't been aware of before?
Not really. I learned that probably to keep out of their way quite a lot, and so the facts they made. It really were outrageous. And me, I was only 19, definitely naive. But I did get back into crazy, at least, of course.
How so?
I was at a convention in Liverpool, and there were a couple of cybermen. I'm afraid that I'm going to do a panel together. So before Fraser came in, I said to the cyberman, I've got this prank. Now you know that stringy, foamy thing? Stringy, what do you call it? It's what? Silly string, that's out of a can. And I said, when I give you the Attah. So, right, it was a sprint Attah. It didn't know anything about it. So all of a sudden, I gave the win in the middle of the interview. And the two phrases, please sign them, coming up to me very slowly. And I didn't quite understand what was going on. Now, phrases is very private to learn. She has a wonderful, silk, grey suit on. Lovely, not lovely. Anyway, they came nearer and nearer. All of a sudden, they let me go. This strange man. Fraser jumped up. All he could say was, "My suit, my suit, my wonderful suit is good." I said, "I've got your hands."
This is it, you've come across something very, very switched on there. Quite a tolerance.
Oh, yeah.
Which is a total contrast to the Victorian Waterford character.
You mean I'm a tomboy still?
Well,
I suppose I am, yes.
It's a very promising, it's a very bright voice part there, definitely.
Yes. Not gone yet.
That's not. What I'm interested in is that when you first picked in Whooverville of the Daleks, you had this lovely, long hair to wear. It's not meant to be climbing alongside behind a bar.
You
know,
like, I don't have a guy. You didn't see my feet, could you? You don't see my feet at all. Today, without the fans, all these people, I would not be here.